Larson. Edward J. Larson is the author of 17 books, including An Empire of Ice, Scott, Shackleton, and the Heroic Age of the Antarctic, and Summer for the Gods, The Scopes Trial and America's Continuing Debate Over Science and Religion, for which he received a Pulitzer Prize. His latest book, The Return of George Washington, 1783-1789, is a critically acclaimed and groundbreaking account of a crucial six-year period of American revolutionary history that is often overlooked. The book is a fascinating analysis of what led George Washington to come out of retirement 4 years after the War of Independence to serve as our first president. Ed holds the Hugh and Hazel Darling Chair in Law at Pepperdine University, where he is also a professor of history. He is a native of Ohio. He received his undergraduate degree from Williams College, his master's and PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and a law degree from Harvard. His articles have appeared in Nature, Atlantic Monthly, Time, Scientific American, and American History. He lives in Georgia and California with his wife, Lucy, a pediatrician, and has two children. Please join me in welcoming Edward Larson.
Thank you so much for that kind introduction, and thank you for coming out on this cold and chilly morning. It's a delight to be here. Having been in California the last few months, it was nice to hear rain last night. I almost forgot what it sounded like. It was wonderful. It's great for sleeping. I thought I'd begin, I'm not planning to read a lot this morning. I'm planning to talk. But I thought I'd begin with just a little reading from the beginning of the book to sort of give you a sense of it, and then I'll start speaking otherwise. So this is how the book begins. It was and remains one of the most remarkable events in the history of war, revolution, and politics. General George Washington retired. Although a spoken act like so much that set him apart, it was less what he said than what he did. On Tuesday, December 23, 1783, the Commander-in-Chief of the American forces during the just-concluded Revolutionary War, accompanied by only two trusted aides, strode into the Assembly Chamber at the Maryland State House in Annapolis. Congress had been meeting there ever since fleeing from its own mutinous troops in Philadelphia, the United States' customary seat of government. Self-describedly gray at age 51, following nearly 9 years of wartime service, Washington stood erect, still a towering figure on a solid frame. Only 20 members representing but seven states remained in attendance at the little respected and largely ineffectual Confederation Congress. Washington had arrived in Annapolis the previous Friday to a cannon salute that brought throngs of well-dressed citizens into the streets to hail him as the country's liberator. On Saturday, in accord with his oft-stated intent, he inquired of Congress about the manner of resigning his commission and returning to private life now that the war had ended. Congress requested a formal audience. Following a script prepared over the weekend by a congressional committee chaired by Thomas Jefferson, Washington entered the Assembly Chamber at noon on the 23rd and took a seat opposite the seated President of Congress, his former aide-de-camp, Thomas Mifflin. The other members of Congress also sat, all wearing hats. The French ambassador, Maryland state officials, and leading citizens of Annapolis had entered the hall. Men standing in the rear, women in the galleries above. Once the spectators settled into their places, the President of Congress addressed the general. "Sir, the U.S. and Congress assembled are prepared to receive your communications." Washington rose and bowed to Congress. On this cue, the members doffed their hats but did not stand. This stiff protocol maintained that the members of Congress were respectively superior to the commander-in-chief. Drawing a paper written in his own hand from a coat pocket, Washington then read his final address as a military commander. Scarcely 300 words long, it made history. The great events on which my resignation depended having taken place, Washington began, his hand visibly trembling as he held his speech. I have now the honor of offering my sincere congratulations to Congress and presenting myself before them to surrender into their hands the trust committed to me. Soon he needed both hands to steady the page. After noting the diffidence with which he initially accepted the post, acknowledging the obligations which he owed to the Army in general and his closest aides in particular, and, quote, commending the interest of our dearest country to the protection of Almighty God, Washington concluded, I retire from the great theater of action and bidding an affectionate farewell to this august body under whose orders I have long acted, I here offer my commission and take my leave of all the employments of public life. By this point, all the spectators were weeping. One observer noted, quote, and there was hardly a member of Congress who did not drop tears. Drawing his commission from his coat pocket, Washington then stepped forward and handed it to the president. His resignation duly accepted, Washington bowed again to Congress and was free to go. He stayed only long enough to greet the members following their adjournment and was riding toward his beloved Mount Vernon plantation by 2 o'clock. He had promised Martha that he would be home for Christmas. He kept his word. Extolled by later historians as the signal event that set the country's political course, Thomas Fleming called it the most important moment in American history. Washington's retirement was similarly praised at the time. Citing examples from Julius Caesar to Oliver Cromwell, British propagandists during the war had scoffed at Americans for rebelling against one King George, only to gain another in George Washington. Successful rebel leaders inevitably become tyrants they charge. Indeed, in England, when expatriate American painter Benjamin West predicted during the war that Washington would retire upon the cessation of hostilities, a skeptical King George III reportedly replied, quote, if he does that, he will be the greatest man in the world. Writing from London, after word of Washington's resignation reached that city, West's American student John Trumbull wrote to his father, the governor of Connecticut, that the act, quote, excites the astonishment and admiration of this part of the world. 'Tis a conduct so novel, so inconceivable to people who, far from giving up power they possess, are willing to convulse the empire to acquire more. In America, Washington at once became the second Cincinnati. There it is. And this I picked because this is the first life-size statue of Washington ever made, dressed in a toga. And I don't believe George Washington ever wore a toga. But this is a Cincinnati image, the legendary Roman leader, twice called from his farm and given supreme power to rescue Republican Rome from its enemies, only to relinquish her power and return to his farm once the dangers had passed. After 3 months' reflection on what had transpired, Jefferson commented, quote, the moderation and virtue of a single character probably prevented this revolution from being closed, as most others have been, by a subversion of that liberty it was intended to establish. Even more than the Commander-in-Chief's distinguished and disinterested service during the Revolutionary War, which he had performed without salary and without leave for 8.5 years. Voluntarily surrendering the trappings of power for private life on the Virginia plantation made Washington a venerated American hero and world-renowned personification of Republican virtue. Well, that's where I begin the story. But doesn't that sound like the end? That sounds like the end of a story. And it is this end of the typical story about George Washington. It's a typical story about George Washington. It's the story of his service as a general. That's actually what, there are tens of thousands of books on George Washington. Most of them focus on that. Some focus on his presidency, which is later, but most end basically with where I began. So, what does that beginning say about the book and say about what I'm trying to do? Well, first, I think what I read to you suggests about the way I try to write is I try to write very much on site and deep in the original sources. I like going to a place, feeling a place where Washington was. That's why Morristown is special, because you can feel Washington here. That's why Mount Vernon is special, because you can feel Washington there, and that's important. Place is important to me as an author. Indeed, the first big-selling book I had, the one that won the Pulitzer Prize, was on the Scopes trial, which occurred in a small town called Dayton, Tennessee. And I ended up going there often. Here is one time in front of the courthouse with a fellow, some of you know, Noah Adams, when he had me back there to do a morning edition based there on one of the anniversaries of that trial. That led to many, many trips to Dayton, Tennessee, as I was working on that book, to get a feel for where Bryan lived, where Darrow lived, where Scopes lived, where the fishing hole they went to swim at, what the courthouse was like. It's still there. It helped make the book real. It also taught me to never write about it, that sort of topic again, because 17 trips to Dayton, Tennessee, and I never wanted to go back. My first book after that, when I could basically pick my topic, instead was on the history of science in the Galapagos Islands. And 17 trips to the Galapagos Islands, so I found much more enjoyable. And I soon followed that with one on history of science in Antarctica, which allowed me to go to the South Pole. And to me, Galapagos and Antarctica were much more interesting than Dayton, Tennessee. Nothing against the volunteers. That's what made this book so nice, because Mount Vernon is truly, in so many ways, a perfect place to do research. Of course, here in Morristown doesn't hurt either. I don't know who that is looking out at me, but you recognize the site otherwise. And Morristown is a great place to do research on Mount Vernon, on George Washington. But I was able to get a year-long fellowship at Mount Vernon, lived right on the grounds for a year, was able to walk around the place, get up before the tourists come, and sit on the veranda and work on with my laptop and work on notes, go back at night. George, it loses its feel when there's literally thousands of tour groups walking around. But it is a great place to study Washington. First because of the place. It reflects George Washington. It was his home that he built from what his father and brother had before. But he loved farming, and he transformed the place by revolutionary farming techniques. He changed from being a tobacco farmer, because the crops had the land had basically played out for tobacco, and tells us a lot about his revolutionary instincts, and he was frustrated how the British controlled the tobacco trade. You couldn't freely sell tobacco. You had to sell it through factors in London, because that's what the law required. This was before the revolution. And those factors inevitably took all the money. There's no way you could ever make money growing tobacco, no matter how much you grew, because they would suddenly set the prices and expenses in a way that at the end of the year, no matter how much you brought in, you still owed them a little more money, because they would have to buy all your products and resell them. With wheat, when he would change the wheat, he could market it himself. He could market direct. So he, great entrepreneur, he built a grain mill, a water mill, which you can still see there. It's recreated in perfect form. And he got the finest grinding wheel in the New World. So he could grind quality of grain that he could sell directly to the French market or in China. Ships taking it directly to China, fine grain. He also built the largest whiskey distillery in the New World to produce whiskey. You can get the whiskey yourself, they still make it. I got to help producing it, got to work on it. that sort of sense you can get a feel for this revolutionary man who was frustrated by the ties of Britain, was willing to try new things and innovate. Not that flat image of Washington we usually have, but the very clever entrepreneur who married very well, brought a lot of money into the family when choosing Martha, and then building up his plantation, so he had one of the largest in the Tidewater. He bought four farms around here, so he had five farms, and then, and we'll get to this, bought extensively in the frontier. You can get a feel for that if you're at the place. Also, one of the great advantages of being a Mount Vernon is they have collected a really remarkable archives there. And another factor that you get a sense of if you're there is, if you're there at Mount Vernon, is what he was like. Now, this, you get to see 17 pairs of his false teeth, for example. It's a picture I took of one of them. And we don't think of Washington as a speaker and a writer, because he wasn't a public speaker, like Lincoln, for example, like so many great public speakers. Well, this was part of the reason. He had these terrible teeth, and he had one tooth left by this time, and that was right up in here. And so they would build in teeth, that's the hole, that would be anchored on this one tooth. And so he put these false teeth in, anchored on this one tooth, but you can imagine they sort of move around. They're mostly typically made out of ivory. He never had teeth made out of wood. Whatever the rumors you hear, I've seen 17 pair of them. He never had them made out of wood, but he was, as he was a heavy tea drinker. And if you have teeth made out of walrus ivory, because that's what the ivory typically used, it picks up the tea stain. And so they look, might look like wood, but they're made out of ivory. The trouble is there's a contraption in there hooked on this one tooth, and so he couldn't really make a public speech because his teeth. But he was actually a wonderful, wonderful, lively conversationalist. He was a storyteller. You learn when you spend time there and when you're reading his letters and things collected in his archives that he was a wonderful conversationalist. People loved to talk with him. When he was here in Morristown, people would love to talk with him. When he was in Philadelphia, it was a wonderful one-on-one or small group conversationalist, because then the teeth wouldn't get in his way. He was a storyteller like, well, famously Ronald Reagan would tell these great stories. But here he was telling stories about the Revolutionary War and battles. And he was a frontline general, so he knew what was happening. So he'd tell these great stories, like Reagan would, in small groups. And people loved to talk to him. He also he loved to hunt, he loved to fish. He was a great dancer. Whenever he was a great socializer. He loved plays. In Philadelphia, he was very close friends with Elizabeth Powell, who was also a very close friend of his wife. And Elizabeth Powell was the finest lady in Philadelphia. And they would go to plays all the time. Washington loved plays. His favorite book was Don Quixote, but he loved reading plays. He loved going to plays. In Philadelphia back then, they couldn't show a play inside Quaker Philadelphia. They were outside the city limits of the playhouses, and he would go outside often with Elizabeth Powell to go to the plays. He would dance with Etta Ball. Every lady wanted to dance with him because, you know, he was drop-dead handsome. He was 6 foot, 2-3 inches tall, so that made him tall for his time. He was built like an oak tree. He was a large, solidly built, great horseman. Back then, horsemanship was equivalent to athleticism, because people didn't play lacrosse back then. They rode horses, and he was a tremendous horseman. And so he would always stay to dance with all the ladies. He was a great card player. He was a great played cards. He was a conversationalist. He was a people person. And when you're in Mount Vernon, you get a feel for it. The guests he would have in Mount Vernon, great story going into there, is people would constantly visit at Mount Vernon. People would want to meet with the great man, but also his former associates would come. People would want to talk to him about building a nation. The great thing about dealing with this book, with my book, is I deal with the time when he's a private citizen. When he's a public citizen, when he's general, or when he's president, he believes he has a role to play. So he, and he very much, since he can't speak very well publicly in groups, he commands with a glance, a nod. People will never forget people, the way he'd look at people, the way he'd nod to people, the way he'd bow, the way he'd move his, he'd show expression. A tremendous power. Loved plays. And he could act. In fact, John Adams, who never had a nice word to say about anyone, and always had a little cut in every comment he'd get, he said, once was asked about Washington, he said that after, this was after he'd been vice president to Washington for 8 years, and he was a little bit jealous of the man, said, he was the greatest political actor I've ever seen. And we don't think of Washington that way, but when you're studying these years between his generalship and his presidency, you can see Washington the man in private life, with his hair down, as it were, and you get to see how he acted with people. And you get to feel that in a very special way in Mount Vernon. So you can see him in that way. Now, as a conversationalist, as a party goer, as a man seriously concerned about the nature of his country. And that brings me to the other point. Why would I write about George Washington? If one looks at my books, you tend to see that I tend to write about gaps in the historical record. That is, where a subject is otherwise well known, but tends to be either misunderstood, that is, there is an urban legend out there of what happened, or just not followed too closely. That would be true in my Scopes book. When I wrote about the Scopes book, everybody basically viewed the Scopes trial as about like Inherit the Wind, which is a great play. And I became very close friends with Bob Lee and Jerry Lawrence, who wrote the play. But it wasn't the story of what really happened there. That Inherit the Wind had actually been written somewhat like The Crucible, where that was written to expose McCarthyism, so was Inherit the Wind. It really wasn't about the Scopes trial. And I was the first historian to ever write a book about the Scopes trial, and I treated it as a historical subject, and ended up with a very different story. The Galapagos, well known about when Darwin was there, I wrote about the periods other than Darwin. Antarctica, I didn't write, focus on Shackleton and Scott getting to the going to the South Pole. I wrote about the scientists working down there, which was an equally gripping story. And the 1800 election, there have been a lot of books in general about Jefferson and Adams, but no book ever focused on a blow-by-blow description of the 1800 election, which ended up becoming a great favorite of the sitting president then, and it enabled me to have my one trip to the White House, where George Bush asked me to come because it ended up being the favorite book by Karl Rove. And so George Bush, I figured, don't you have better things to do than talk to me for an hour? But why look a little nervous? Well, if you're talking to him, he looks very comfortable with me. I was very nervous with him. But he loved the book, and it was his favorite book of the year, he said, and so he had me over to talk about it. So how can I write a book about Washington, the most written about person in American history? Well, what I began to see when I thought about writing this book, I'd written this book about the 1800 election, which was just after this period, and Washington actually played a role. He died during the election period, and he played a role early in it, so he's featured in the first chapter of the book. But I taught history for years. And I would teach the first half of American history at the University of Georgia. And when, if you're an American history teacher, you usually spend a day or two in the Revolution, and it's all about George Washington, where he features very prominently, as does Morristown. And then, a couple days later, you have a class or two on the presidency, and it's all about the first president, it's all about George Washington. But there's a day or two in between when you're talking about the collapse of the Confederation, which I alluded to, in my early reading. There was a period you talk about when the country was falling apart, when the Confederation, Articles of Confederation, did not work. They couldn't pay the troops because they couldn't raise funds. They didn't have the power to build an army, so they couldn't defend the frontier. And the Americans tended to think at that time that their future was the frontier. What made America different was, unlike England or France, where we were all, where everybody became what their parents became because the country was full and closed. America was different, people believed back then, and whether it was Washington or Franklin or whoever, because we had a frontier where people could always move to the frontier. The wealthier people could invest in the frontier and make their fortune, as Washington was trying to do before the Revolution, and the people who weren't yet wealthy could move to the frontier and build their fortune there, as many Americans did. And so the fact that the frontier was critical. After the Revolution, we had no army, we had no troops to defend the frontier. The British never even left the frontier forts. And so the British had remained in the frontier. They didn't, even though they had technically ceded the frontier, the Native Americans were moving back in. Washington, when he went west during this period to look at his frontier properties, could not even reach most of the frontier properties because he was told that the Native Americans had taken them back over and they were waiting to ambush them. That had happened 2 years before to his agent out there who was watching these properties. He had been captured, roasted alive, scalped, roasted alive, and then killed. And Washington didn't want that to happen to him, so he went out to the frontier, he came back. Two-thirds of Georgia had already been recaptured by the Native Americans who had moved in the frontier. When he got to the frontier, the frontier's people were actively working with either the Brits, because the only way they could get their goods to market was up the St. Lawrence or down the Mississippi, so either leaning with Britain or leaning with Spain, which then controlled New Orleans, and the frontier. The frontier was being lost. The states were fighting against each other because there was no freedom of interstate commerce. So New Jersey was being extorted by New York, who was charging huge tariffs to send goods to out of New York Harbor. And so the governor of New York was basically exporting all the taxes to New Jersey and Connecticut by the way he controlled trade, the way that George Clinton controlled trade. The country was falling apart. Vermont was actively conspiring to leave the Union altogether and join with British Canada. Washington saw everything that Washington had fought and died, and his troops had died. He had led an army for 9 years, and he sent many men to their death. And he was fighting for something new. Individual liberty, economic opportunity and economic freedom and private property, and sovereignty. And all of those things were being lost. Rhode Island, Georgia, other states were printing paper money like it was going out of style and commanding creditors to make it, and the paper money was virtually worthless, and that was undermining private property. Washington, all that was happening, that led to the Constitutional Convention. And when you tell the conventional story, Washington disappears from that period. And I always thought, and this was what led to me writing the book, is that possible? Here was the most famous man in the world, the greatest American, beloved throughout America, who had fought 9 years without pay or leave to win American independence, to protect individual liberty, and protect private property. And it was all being lost. Would he just sit on his plantation and do nothing? And so I want to see, what was Washington do during that period? And what I found was he was at the center of all the action. All the people involved with the movement toward a union that would protect individual rights, that would protect private property, that would allow the country to raise taxes and raise an army to defend its borders, to put retaliatory tariffs on Europe so that we could get a fair deal in trade, that would build an army to protect the frontier and open the frontier for America's future. He was at the center of all of it. I can work through his ledgers to see who was coming to Mount Vernon, and we find out that everyone was coming to Mount Vernon. Madison spent more time in Mount Vernon during those years than he spent at his own home. And when the 2 months leading up to the Constitutional Convention, he lived at Mount Vernon. That's where the Virginia Plan was drafted that led to the Constitutional Convention. Washington was, the letters, hundreds and hundreds of letters back and forth with people like John Jay and Henry Knox, who was Secretary of War and his top assistant from Massachusetts, and the Pinckneys of South Carolina, and the Morrises of Philadelphia, Gouverneur Morris, then of New York and of Philadelphia, and Robert Morris. They were all coming to Mount Vernon. That's where the whole scheme was hatched. And then, at the Constitutional Convention, he was at the center of all of it. He disappears somewhat because Madison's notes is the record. The Constitutional Convention was a closed, there were no reporters there. It worked internally, and all we have is Madison's notes, and he records the notes of what's spoken. And because George Washington was the president of the convention, he did not speak except to call on people. But neither does the Speaker of the House of Representatives, and yet he's putting together the deals. And we find out that Washington, if you start following closely, he was meeting with the members. That whenever an important decision was made, such as the Great Compromise that had the House and Senate divided, the states and when the Three-Fifths Compromise, when all the compromises that kept the thing going were put forward, he was having those people to his house the night before, or meeting with them the night before. He was calling on them. In other words, he was part of the overall structure. When the Virginia Plan was drafted formally, he was at every meeting. Hamilton, Jay, and Madison to write the Federalist Papers. It was his request. He then would take them and send them out to other newspapers to republish them. And then he was at the center of the drive for the first federal election. Washington was at, well, if you ever live in the South, as I did for a while, you find out if you're flying Delta, you can't fly anywhere without going through Atlanta. Well, it was the same way with Mount Vernon. And that's the story I was able to tell, and that's why his resignation was the start of the story. Because it was the fact that he resigned power voluntarily rather than clenching it. Look at all the revolutions around the world. People, to this day, people don't give up power. And the result is either chaos, as we're seeing in places like Libya today, or tyranny, as we see in other places. We saw in Russia, we saw in China. He resigned power. That's what made people trust him. Not the fact that he won the war, but he resigned power, and that made him trust him to build a new, stronger federal union, and adopt it. And person after person at the time, virtually everyone said, there is no way that either the Constitutional Convention would have succeeded, or the Constitution would have been then ratified by the states if it hadn't been faith in George Washington. He made the people confident, willing to accept this radical transformation of power because they trusted him with power. So that's why I begin with his resignation. And of course, then when he becomes president, he also voluntarily steps down when he could easily stay in office. So I was able to write about that in-between period. It was indeed a privilege, and of course, that's what brought me to Morristown, because Morristown, as well as Newburgh, New York, as well as Mount Vernon, they're all part of the story. Now I'd love to take some questions if possible. Thank you. Gone to his frontier properties. And this is his trip out. You can see in the black line, this just drawn for me, in fact, it's the first time. time I've used it. And he got out to the frontier properties, as I said, he couldn't even visit his more extreme properties, which are the ones down there, great, the further ones down. He couldn't get down that far because the Native Americans already moved in. But there were settlers living up around Pittsburgh on his property. They weren't paying him anything because they didn't feel like they were under the control of the government. But he realized that those, the frontier, the only way the frontier was going to stay connected with America. He came back from this trip just shocked because the frontiersman people didn't care about America anymore. And the key was, he came back, he wrote letters to all the governors saying, we're losing the frontier. Not only do we have an army to defend it, and therefore the Native Americans are moving in, but the people who are living there are going to trade where they have communication. Amen. Their allegiance are going to follow their communication. By communication, he meant trade. And the only way they can get their goods to market is either up through the St. Lawrence River, which was through British Canada, or down the Ohio River and down to the Mississippi, which was through Spain. So he says, we're going to have to link the frontier to the East Coast. And that means, at the time there was no railroads, they didn't exist. And Europe was in a canal building stage. And so England and France, the Netherlands, were being crisscrossed with canals to carry goods to market and to link up industry. And so he said, we're going to have to build canals. Now, the one that eventually works well is the Erie Canal to New York. But his idea was that the closest place to the frontier was going up the Potomac, which would bring the goods to market right by his own plantation in Mount Vernon, up the Potomac and then crossing over to the Ohio River Valley, finding a closest link up, and then have a short overland portage, but basically clear the Potomac for navigation and canal around the few high waterfalls like Great Falls of the Potomac. So there was little bits of canaling. Most of it was dredging. So he comes back convinced on both nationalistic grounds as well as commercial grounds, because it's his own frontier properties, and he's writing to all the governors, the only way we're going to keep the frontier is to connect it. So he takes as an added project, in addition to maintaining his property and rebuilding his plantations from their war town sort of collapse because he'd been away for 9 years, was to build the Potomac Navigation Company, and he gets Virginia and Maryland. Back then, companies were very unusual. The only companies allowed back then, which was limited investment where you weren't liable for all the debts, were companies based on public service. Because remember, most of these people like Robert Morris and James Wilson end up in debtor's prison because they don't have companies to limit liability. And Washington creates a limited liability company, first one ever chartered in two states, simultaneously chartered in Maryland and Virginia because the Potomac goes up through the border. And he becomes president of it, raises funds, and it was just absolutely amazing. Washington's like, he comes back from his trip, he decides this while he's out there. He can't go down to his frontier property, so he bushwhacks. He'd gone out with the whole party. He comes back alone on horseback, looking for where the roads are closer. So you see the dotted line coming back through the mountains. When he can, he stays with frontier settlers. When he can, he just sleeps outside. He's a huge man, you know, and he rides a huge horse. And it's pouring rain like this for much of the time. He sleeps under the stars, and you can read his diary, and he loves it. He's in his 50s, most famous man in the world. But he grew up on the frontier in the sense that he was a surveyor out there. And you can see it was the happiest time of this period. He's sleeping out. He's traveling through a country that looks like this. There is no trails. He follows buffalo trails when he can. He sometimes runs into a cabin. Imagine knocking on the door, and you're living in a cabin in the middle of nowhere, and suddenly George Washington is at your door asking to spend the night. And other times, he just sleeps under the stars. He would raft down the rapids, and he clearly loved it. He was an adventurer. He took his fishing lines with him because he loved the fish. And then he spent these years building this navigation system, which actually does work. But the trouble is the Erie Canal just bad. But the canal does work. It does return some money on investment. and it is a route out. But this becomes a main activity, and it shows one aspect. I know I'm answering too long, but it shows one wonderful aspect of George Washington. George Washington, unlike Thomas Jefferson, who was an idealist, George Washington was a realist. And you can see this in all his letters. For example, he said to some of his people, he says, "You don't understand our troops, madam. You expect them to do all these things. Anybody who believes these troops are doing it," he's talking about the revolution, the depth of the revolution, "are doing it for some ideal vision of liberty, don't understand our troops. They are all doing it for self-interest. They think they will be better off, they and their descendants will be better off in an independent country than part of Britain. They're doing it for their own. Every person works out of his own self-interest. And our job is to align the national interest with individual self-interest." That's a realist. And he said, "So about this great navigation company, sure, I'll gain because this connects to the frontier. You should invest in this because you're going to make a return. But the reason why we should do it is because it's the only thing that's going to keep our country together and maintain the union. So we're all going to be benefited. There's nationalistic purpose for this. It's going to tie the frontier to the coast. But if the country works, we're all going to be better off." And that sense of realism is one reason he was such an effective president. But it was integral to the way he thought about people. That people operate out of self-interest, but we want to align those with the public. So the navigation project reflects so many aspects about what he was and what he hoped to create. So thank you for your question.
Thank you. I'm so sorry. I saw that he had land in Pittsburgh?
Near Pittsburgh, just south of Pittsburgh.
Is it likely that that battle on the hill that he fought in, he actually owned eventually parts of that battle?
He actually, the famous place, the Fort Necessity, was the one that had the battle. He bought that, and he owned it at this time. He bought it after he had done it, and that was one of his investments. But he had these areas up near Pittsburgh, and he had a mill up at Miller's Run, Washington's Bottom, excuse me, Miller's Run. He had land there, and those were part of the investments. Those every square on there is where land that he had acquired before the Revolution. And then tried to capitalize after the revolution on it.
Thank you.
I'll try to be shorter with the next question. Great question.
I've just nearly finished Ron Chernow's tome on Hamilton.
Yes. Yes.
Hamilton is.
It almost inspires you to make a rap musical, doesn't it? That's a great idea. It might get you a MacArthur Award.
Hamilton was portrayed as not only Washington's aide-de-camp, but after the war as essential to getting the Constitution written and adopted. And Chernow makes it sound as though Hamilton was essential to the country existed. What does your research show with regard to Hamilton and Washington?
Well, I'm a huge fan of Chernow. That's not exactly how I read that part of the book. But certainly Hamilton, the Hamilton-Washington partnership was very important. He'd been his aide during the Revolution, and certainly their relationship broke down toward the end of it. And Hamilton did not come to Washington's farewell with the officers. And they didn't communicate up until the time of the Constitutional Convention. They had basically broken because Hamilton was ambitious and did things that, ambitious for a stronger union, and did things, and Hamilton admitted this is what they had their falling out over, had used the army to try to gain a better deal for creditors. And that blew up in the Newburgh Conspiracy. And so Washington had thought that Hamilton had misused the army to basically make a threat that they would have a coup d'etat if you don't pay off the creditors, and that Hamilton was too closely tied to the creditor faction, which was later the rub against Hamilton with the National Bank and other activities. Actually, Hamilton very, very strongly believed in the National Union. And he at the Constitutional Convention famously argued that the state should be abolished. There should be no states, which is what happens in France during the Revolution. All the original provinces of France were abolished and they were turned into one administrative districts, and that's what Hamilton wanted. He was the opposite of states' rights, more extreme than Washington. And yet you needed that outlier. And Washington then comes to realize during the Constitutional Convention that while he always had a certain distrust of Hamilton's willingness to use extreme means, Washington cared about means and ends. And Hamilton cared only about ends. But their ends were very close. And so after he storms out of the Constitution, he's not in court at the Constitutional Convention because he storms out when they adopt the Great Compromise that preserves the states and gives each state two members of the Senate. He storms out and he leaves. He just leaves the Constitutional Convention. Washington agreed to that compromise. It wasn't in the Virginia plan, but he agreed to it. Franklin invented it. He handed it over to Roger Sherman to propose, and that's who gets the credit. It was Franklin's idea, and Washington was on board. And so, but in the end, Washington realizes, and they do work together, that you sort of need that stalking horse out there at the extreme to help Washington make the compromises. Washington's a listener and a compromiser. He greatly respected Hamilton's brilliance. Washington knew he wasn't brilliant. He was wise, but he wasn't brilliant. And Hamilton was a detail person. And then he turns to Hamilton to help write the Federalist Papers to get it passed. Brilliant, and he admired that as the finest document of political writing ever in the New World, Washington said. And then when Robert Morris declines being Treasury Secretary, he turns to Hamilton to be the Treasury Secretary. And certainly during the presidency, he relies heavily on Hamilton to devise the economic changes, such as the tariffs and the National Bank, that helped bind the Union together. And Washington respected that. But Washington and Hamilton sort of have a father-son relationship. Washington, of course, has no children, and he becomes the surrogate father to many people, like Lafayette and Madison and Hamilton. And as long as Washington was around, he could sort of keep Hamilton focused and not self-destructive. And when Washington dies, of course, Hamilton goes off the rails. And, he exercises his screed against John Adams. He can't be controlled. It leads to his ultimate death in the duel. So in many ways, Washington was the governor that kept Hamilton under control. So when they were at their best, they were a good team. And they had some great, they was a great legacy for our country. Yes? And she's got to watch my time. Okay.
What are the
Rich, you wanted to say something?
Political
Rich?
Beliefs,
you have a question?
Actions?
Yeah. This gentleman right here.
Practices that Washington had that
it needs to be, yeah, I'll be back.
That you think would be valuable for politicians today in the three branches?
I think it's style as much as anything. Washington was trying first, ideologically, politically. Washington was a political general. When he was a general, certainly he was a field general, but he was a political general. And so when we think about, oh, generals make bad presidents, and think of Zachary Taylor or something, think of Eisenhower, who was a very effective president. He had been a political general working out D-Day. Washington kept had to keep the French involved, he had to work with all the state militias, and he always had councils of war where everybody would speak before they made final decisions. He was the same way as president. He invented the cabinet. The cabinet's not in the Constitution. He invented it because he liked to hear people talk. It was the stuff. He wanted a stronger union. He had devised what was needed from the Constitutional Convention, and what he wanted was the national control over interstate commerce, which didn't exist, but that was very important to him. Dormant Commerce Clause, all those bits he cared about. International commerce, the power to tax and spend for the general welfare, and control over the national militia and national armies, and the state militias. That's strong in federal government, but he's willing to compromise on federalism, some role for the states. That was important. But also, he was willing to listen and then take from the pieces, figure out what was in everyone's best self-interest, try to align those, and then compromise. And I think those skills, his willingness to listen to all sides. Doris Kearns Goodwin wrote a great book about Lincoln where he called a team of rivals, and he brought rivals into the cabinet. That's nothing compared to George Washington. He brought Hamilton and Jefferson and Henry Knox and John Adams into the same cabinet, and I could keep naming them. That was a real team of rivals, and he knew they were different. He wanted to hear from them all, and Madison, who was like his chief advisor, hear all of them, think about it, and then work out a compromise that he would not compromise on ends, but compromise on means to get there. That's the sort of leadership that worked, and I think it's still the sort of leadership that works. We have one more question. Thank you. And then we'll close.
You answered part of it in this previous talk. One of the things where any president, any governor comes into office, there's a transition team. But everything works. The post, the armies go, the mail is delivered, people go to work. Washington comes in basically as a startup government. There are no laws. There's no banking. There's not even any way other than collecting money on a tariff. He's already worked a compact. He's shown that with Maryland and with Virginia. Do you think that there's any president, I don't even want to go on today, any president that's capable of starting a startup business as George Washington did, the startup of the United States?
You're certainly right that he faced a unique situation. The only person who would have a comparable walking into a comparable situation with Abraham Lincoln, because the country had fallen apart in the two parts before he took office. Because he was a national figure, remember, he had traveled all over the Union during the Revolution. He had worked closely with governors, had close relationships all the way from Massachusetts to Virginia, and then close ties down into Georgia and South Carolina. And he knew the country the way no one else could. He had been a practical man of business also, and because of that, he could had a unique position to what was needed to create a nation. And so he had to make those decisions. He had to build a tariff system. He had to build a national collection system. He had to build a national army, and West Point, of course, was his idea for doing that. But those sort of activities, no one walked into that situation before, and he prepared. There wasn't any, just take Tom Jefferson's role. It was Thomas Jefferson's role. Of course, there wasn't a national capital. Jefferson helps work to be at Washington, D.C. There wasn't even an intellectual property system. Jefferson creates that. He draws on different talents to pull together the pieces to create an effective country. And by the time the 8 years is over, we do have a working country, not just with tariffs, but with a taxing system that includes taxations down to individuals, and effective control of the frontier with an army, and respect abroad with other countries working out deals with fair tariffs and negotiating with other countries. So yes, Washington deals with all those situations by relying and working with others, never by doing it all himself or ever claiming to do it all himself. In a way, it was the first hidden hand presidency, much like Eisenhower's talked about. And so, in that way, he's a public figure traveling, but building a team that accomplishes the Federalist ideology for America. And I'm being called off, so I'll have to go. Thank you.
Morristown.